This is Ham Radio Now episode, I don't know what number this is going to be, but it is from the HamCation down here in Orlando. And I've got a guy from FlexRadio and a guy not from FlexRadio, but wearing a FlexRadio shirt. We will find out why in just a moment. And we'll do a little commercial for them first, and then I'm going to talk about software-defined radio. So let's find out who we got. Tim, tell people who you are. You're the guy from FlexRadio.
Yes. Good morning, Gary. My name is Tim Ellison. I'm with FlexRadio Systems. I'm the customer experience manager, which basically means that I'm responsible for everybody's wonderful experience using our products. And I'm glad to be here and glad to be able to talk with you this morning.
We see you mostly around the Southeast, right?
Yes, I work remotely out of the North Carolina, the Raleigh area, and I've come to a lot of the Ham Fest east of the Mississippi and several of them out west when necessary.
All right, and you have a FlexRadio shirt, but you're not from FlexRadio. Who
yes,
are you?
Yes, I'm Don Baughman. I'm K7MX, and I'm a longtime advocate and friend of FlexRadio. I've been involved with them on a volunteer basis since, way back in the early days with Gerald and the experimental status of SDR when he was doing it on his kitchen table.
So they paid you by giving you a shirt?
Yeah, the shirt was relatively free, yes.
And so you hang around the booth and just help them out.
Yeah. I'm essentially retired, come out of the electronics industry as an engineer and then sales and marketing guy. And as I said, I'm a very enthusiastic advocate of SDR in general and FlexRadios in particular. I offer assistance where I can.
I will have you move up on the mic a little, or you can pull a little closer to you, because we're going to get more and more noise as things go on. So the commercial, you guys got a new product.
Yes, we have the new Power Genius XL. It's a solid state, full legal limit RF amplifier. We'll do 1500 watts on 160 through 6 meters. It's fully integrated into our smart SDR software ecosystem and works seamlessly with all of our Flex 6000s radios, the 6300, 65, and 6700. It's a great little product. It's a Ethernet-based connectivity. We don't use CAT or PTT connections for the connection to the radio itself. You plug the amplifier into your network along with your 6000. They see one another, sync right up, and then you have yourself a 1500-watt transceiver.
So being solid state, it's all that no tune. Yeah, no, you're not dipping the plate in final because you don't have a plate.
Right, exactly.
it's on.
Yes.
What does it have to look into to be happy? Really good antenna?
Well, obviously it helps to have resonant antennas whenever you're running solid-state amplifiers, but it will handle a mismatch of an SDR up to 2.5. Fairly easily, and we have a companion tuner. It's actually an antenna coupler that's in the works that we'll be announcing here shortly, the next several months. And it's going to be a wide range antenna coupler that you can use either at the antenna feed point in a headless mode, or with the amplifier in a with the control head on it. And that will also seamlessly connect up the same way. It'll plug into the network. They'll all communicate with one another. It'll see the amp and sync right up. So basically it's a zero configuration type of scenario that you'll run into with these devices.
How rich will I have been before I buy one of these, and how poor will I be after I have it?
Well, I was going to say, ham radio is not a poor man's hobby,
I got a Baofeng radio. Just put $37 into it plus shipping.
But the amplifier is on par with other full legal limit solid state amplifiers, and the amplifier is $6,999.
All right.
We'll call it $7,000. Yeah. We'll round up one.
Is that on the market now, or is it standby?
We're taking reservations for the amplifier now. You put down a deposit, and we expect the amp to be shipping this summer or sooner.
They're not giving you one, are they, Don?
No, they're not giving me one. But I might add from a technology perspective, as I said, I come from the engineering world. So Ranko 403 Alpha, who was the designer of this amplifier, has quite a good reputation in the amateur world for...
I'll get you even closer.
For really high-quality products. And the design of this amplifier fascinated me. It's using the very latest LDMOS finals in there, and as opposed to some other amplifiers using a single 1500-watt module to get 1500 watts out, Ranko's design team put two of them in there, two of the very latest technology. So it has the capacity of 3000 watts. It is designed through software to
run. Who are we talking to? California now?
Yeah, California is pretty easy.
Europe?
No.
I'm talking about market people.
Oh,
3,000 watt amplifier.
Californians
and Europeans are the ones I've heard
about.
Yeah.
Well, the beauty behind it is it's not working really hard to get to 1,500 watts. It's very conservatively rated at 1,500 watts. It has some circuitry, some very unique circuitry in there that optimizes the IMD. So not only is it very strong, but it's very clean. The transmitted signal will set new standards for IMD in a full legal limit amplifier with basically no limit on duty cycle.
It's not software defined. At that point, you can't be software defined anymore.
It's software assisted. There is there is software in the amplifier that that in virtually real time looks at the signal and optimizes the characteristics, the IMD characteristics of the amplifier, as well as the drive levels. It ensures that you get maximum power without stressing the amplifier.
Yeah, that's what we say. And it is the truth. If something is overbuilt, it is going to last longer.
True.
Unless you use the overbuilt nature of it illegally.
Well, the amplifier as designed has limits in there, and the FCC certifies it to those limits. I think it's going to be universally well accepted, but it does have a lot of capability and reserve.
Okay. So that's your commercial. Here's my commercial. Ham Radio Now is brought to you, not by Flex. If you enjoy the programs and get something out of them, stop by hamradionow.tv. See Arvin sitting down there at the bottom of the page. You can make a contribution through PayPal, credit card. Patreon is our subscription monthly, dollar a month for everybody watching. It would be awesome. That's the end of my commercial. hamradionow.tv.
Got to pay the bills.
So, and I appreciate all you guys out there who do. It's wonderful. So the other thing I wanted to talk about was I was actually talking to an ICOM salesperson here at the show, at the Orlando HamCation. And ICOM's got a software-defined radio product, the 7300. They are about to release their second and one step or two up the food chain. I think it's the 7610, something like that.
Correct.
And so what I asked him, and so ICOM has got two software-defined products. Flex is... always been, you know, started software-defined. Ellicraft puts their software-defined under the hood, and they're not direct conversion yet. I haven't talked to those guys to see if they've got direct conversion in the works, but I expect they gotta. Direct conversion means, you guys should explain what direct conversion means, but you come out of
it's
the
coax. It's a little bit of an anomaly, but yeah.
Come out of the coax connector and maybe some sort of a front-end filter, and then into the A to D converter. And digits are coming out of the antenna port pretty much after that point, and everything else is done in software.
Right.
That's direct conversion. You could, and what has been done in the past, is go through a couple of steps of analog to the intermediate frequency and then go into the A to D converter. Lots of advantages in the direct conversion, and it wasn't done initially because it was too hard, too expensive.
Well, I might just correct. Direct conversion is actually Flex Radio's first level of SDR radios with the Flex 1500, 3000, 5000. Those were direct conversion to baseband, and then the computer did all the conversion. The technology in use today is direct RF sampling. So it's a direct sample radio, which is also the same thing that that ICOM is doing. Somewhat different than direct conversion.
Okay. I got myself confused because back in the 3000, 1500, it wasn't right off of the antenna connector.
That's
for Flex.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay. It was the 6000 series that you started doing.
Correct.
And the guys that I'm familiar with that were doing that a few years before that were the guys at Tapper, the HP SDR. Apaches down the road, they're basically making a commercial version of the HP SDR. So you're not the only ones that have done it, but commercially, you've sort of been the first.
The first ones, correct.
Yeah. But what I was asking him was, SIACOM's got two products. Yaesu's got none on the market right now. Got to imagine that in their laboratories, they're feverishly working on something. Kenwood, nothing yet. Feverishly working, I'm sure. Right, Kenwood? So I asked the ICOM guy, how long until software-defined is not a feature, it's a given? And he didn't have a date to say, but 5-10 years out, everything is software-defined because it's better.
Right.
You just do so many more things. So then, where does Flex hang its hat? And what about our viewers? How are they going to interpret one software defined versus another? Mm-hmm. Now, you guys obviously have your Flex. You got a point to make. And the other guys, if they want to come on the show and talk about what their advantages might be, that welcome to do that. But from your point of view, what should our viewers be looking for in differentiation of software defined once everybody's software defined?
Sure. Well, that's a really great question. And between Don and I think we'll get most of the points covered. But I'd like to point out is that radios for the last probably 20 years have had some level of software defined in them. Whether it's been a DSP at the IF in a traditional multi-stage superhet radio, all the way up to the new radios where we're doing direct sampling, which essentially the wideband A to D converter is connected directly to the antenna port, and we're digitizing RF directly. And it's been an evolutionary process. Even our Flex 5000, 6000 lines was an evolutionary process. What we're seeing now is I think the level of which it has come mainstream. And so I don't think we're seeing it's necessarily a feature. I think what we're seeing is everybody else starting to catch up. And the advantages are multifold. What I think
we could do a 3-hour show various pieces of software defined that make it wonderful.
But I think that what you're seeing is that the core value proposition, which is driving this, is that you buy the hardware once and you get multiple features in your radio without having to sell a radio for a loss and buy another piece of hardware. So the paradigm in the ham radio market is changing in that regard, is that there's more emphasis on the software and the quality of the software than there is necessarily on the features that are brought to the market by the hardware. And so, I think where your differentiators are going to start showing up with the ICOMs and the Anons and this fact is it's really going to come down to the software. We're fairly proud that we've been in this business for going on 15 years now, and we've got a lot of experience in the ham market and in the commercial and government space building SDRs, and we bring that knowledge to the table and allow that to filter down into our ham products. And so what you're seeing, particularly if you're talking about the difference between something like an ICOM radio versus a smart SDR radio, is it's going to be the software that really is going to be the differentiator. ICOM has chosen to take a traditional radio format, a radio with a big VFO knob and a lot of controls on the front of it, and put software-defined capabilities inside that type of platform, where historically FlexRadio has done it a little bit differently. We've done it where we put the power of the user interface and the power of the radio actually in the software itself, and so it's going to be where the market is going to drive is people are going to be making decisions on the quality of software, the quality of support that they get, and the kind of features that the manufacturers are bringing to the market.
Flex acknowledged the hams that like to turn knobs and push buttons.
Absolutely.
By introducing the Maestro control service. which has lots of its own special capabilities. You need to walk around the house carrying your ham radio, talking to the black box, you know, in the closet someplace, which is cool. And I haven't asked about how well it's been going. I think you've been sold out pretty much perpetually.
Yes.
So it must be either you can't make enough or you're selling them really well.
It's a combination of both.
Yeah. So clearly there was a desire for hams to do what Flex is doing, but to do it in a more traditional format.
Right.
And you gave them a version of a more traditional format.
Yes.
And Steve gave a talk that I didn't get to catch on contesting with the Maestro.
Right.
So you're oriented to that niche as well. I guess both for for anybody who's going to do it in contest, because that was the one of the complaints, is that the radio's going through software is too fiddly.
I think the Maestro filled a couple of gaps, honestly. There were that segment, I mean, those who are advocates already of Flex Radio and the way Smart SDR and Power SDR work, were already convinced it was a better way to go. The contest community is a very demanding community. And they like things to be very controlled. You want to have focus on what you're doing. And with the original and still existent Smart SDR, you didn't always have focus. You had to have multiple monitors and that sort of stuff. So Maestro solved a couple of problems. Those people who wanted something that had knobs and buttons and switches, the Maestro provides that for the average user. For the contester, those knobs and buttons and switches are organized in such a manner that really lends itself to contesting. It's very intuitive and very obvious for the contester to use that, just like they use their, not just like, but better than they use their traditional radios. It's all about rate in contesting.
Yeah.
You don't want to have to focus back and forth between things. So Maestro served two purposes, and it's been very successful.
I haven't played with one. Are all the buttons user-definable?
They're not user-definable as such. They're usable, user-adjustable. And Tim might be able to address that a little better, but there was great involvement on the part of some very high-profile contesters and high-end users, DXers, in the placement and layout and the functions available on Maestro. It's not an exact duplicate set of everything that's on Smart SDR. It's what you need for contesting and operating in harsh environments. I mean, Tim, you might add to that.
Yeah, what we did is... We looked at the workflow process under contesting, and I think what Don was alluding to is that, you know, anytime you can shave a quarter of a second off of a QSO and you multiply that by 24 hours, you know, that's a higher rate, and that's what, you know, the contesting group is looking for. And so the most used type controls for the AGC type control, filtering control, tuning, RIT, XIT, things of that nature that a high workflow type of environment requires, those are fixed type knobs. But we do have controls that are user definable. We have up to 12 user definable controls that you know, the user can assign to different tasks to bring them front forward in their operating environment.
How many knobs are on there? How many knobs or buttons?
Never counted them.
I remember Riley Hollingsworth doing a talk where he's comparing radios across the years. This radio from the 70s, it's got 12 buttons and knobs and one big knob. This is the one big knob talk. I don't know if you've seen that. And then somewhere in the mid-80s, it's up to 20. And then he was looking at, I think, at a Yaesu ad. It's one of their big radios. 57 buttons and knobs, but it's still got one big knob. So clearly you are making the knob and button people happy.
Yeah.
And the total software interface people happy.
Right. Yes, they've been very well received. Back to your original question, earlier question about Flex's implementation of SDR and the now emerging other people who are doing it. I think Flex, of course, has been in it for a long time. They didn't invent SDR, but they certainly perfected it for the amateur community. And I think there are, I was at one of the talks that Gerald gave yesterday about where do you go now. And the platform as it exists, Smart SDR exists now, it's very, very capable and extensible. And it's the future looks like the radio as a server. The radio will be a server. So you'll have
RF server.
Yeah, you'll have multiple ways to access your radio rather than a box sitting in front of you with buttons and knobs on it. The radio lives on your network, and it is a server to whatever device you choose to approach it with, whether it's a Maestro, whether it's an iPad, whether it's some other type of device in the future. It's an extensible platform for your radio. It's eminently remotable. And as Tim said, the software development, rather than being specific to a box, is looking forward. So it's a forward-looking and a very extensible platform on the part of Smart SDR.
Yeah, and as part of that, it is upgradable just by downloading some software. And,
absolutely.
I mean, putting in literally new feature to the radio that does something for RF, not just...
Right. I think it's interesting to look at software-defined radios historically. This is not something that's brand new. It may be brand new to the ham community, but software-defined radios have been around forever. Some of the earliest spacecraft used software-defined receivers because they knew that as they were out there, they may need to reconfigure them. It's just simply been too expensive for the average person.
Reload, reboot, cross your fingers because no one's going up there to fix it.
Correct. But the fact is that the SDR technology has been around, but it was too expensive until the last 15 or so years with high-speed A to D converters, field programmable gate arrays as we have today, to allow it to be done for the mortal man.
Yeah. I remember a great talk in 2008 by Phil Harmon, I think, Australian ham, at the Tapper conference, describing how he worked on the software for, I think it was the Mercury receiver, software-defined receiver that HPSDR and Tapper were working on.
Right.
He said, if I wanted to make a $100,000 receiver, I could do that easily, but I wanted to make a less than $1,000 receiver. And so now I had to learn all the corners that I could cut. And he described in that talk, which is on ham radio now, you can watch it if you want, all the corners and tricks that he worked out so that he could use, it was the cheaper hardware, and still make it perform very, very well.
Right.
And that was the first time I heard about direct sampling, if I got the the terminology right now.
Yeah.
That was one of the first direct sampling receivers that I had heard about.
Yeah, correct.
So I'm guessing that writing software for a software-defined radio is not cookie cutter and it is not easy.
That's a fair assessment. You know, the Flex 6000, is an embedded system. There are multiple processors in the radio that are suited for doing different functions that make an SDR an SDR. And so you have to write software for the FPGA, you have to write software for the DSP, you have to write software for the kernel and the PSOC, and all of that has to work together. And anytime you do embedded systems programming, there's a little bit of a dance there. So yes, it's not for the faint-hearted.
Do Apple, Google, and Facebook get all the good engineers, or is there some left over for doing this?
Absolutely not. I think we have some of the best engineering talent and software development talent that's around. The guys that work for us and work for Steve and Eric, they're absolutely phenomenal. The kind of stuff that they can turn out, and we're really, really, really proud and very fortunate to have them on our team.
Yeah, I don't think it's any secret. In fact, Gerald was talking about it the other day, that the genesis for a lot of the baseline architecture presently used in Flex's radios came from a government contract looking for very high performance multi-receiver capability, and that was leveraged into what we see today. And another sort of cool testament is that there are two Flex 6700s flying right now on the International Space Station for an experiment for ocean-going data gathering.
Okay, not in ham service.
Not in ham service, but they are essentially Flex 6700s in a rack up on the space station right now.
Did those have to get a lot of specialized treatment so they could get through all the rigors of testing and performance?
They were used by a system integrator because of their capability. They then put it into a rack using some other equipment to massage the data coming out of it, but they're essentially Flex 6700s.
Did they ever come back to you and say, we need to change this part or that, you know, that mounting bracket or something?
I don't think they've shot them back down quite yet.
Well, I mean, before they sent them up, I mean, I'm sure they ran them through the gauntlet. Yeah. And did they come back and say, can you make a few tweaks for us?
Well, we had to make some changes to the geometry of the packaging because there's unique packaging requirements for putting anything in space. But essentially, the radios are as is.
And software configured to the needs of the
Absolutely.
People that are using them.
Absolutely. Yes. They had some specific requirements on the type of data that they needed to get out of the system. So that it could be digitized and transmitted back down to Earth for analysis, and we made those software changes for them.
And sent it back up.
Yeah.
And they do have someone up there that can reboot it if they need to. there is a service tech sort of up there.
Right.
I think they're all service techs, actually.
Yeah.
Yep. I didn't ask you guys this question. How many years until it's all SDR? Until it's, you know, when is that going to happen?
Ooh, that's the $64,000 question. I think Vegas probably is going to be better at answering that kind of question on the over-under on that. But, for SDR technology, it has been progressing at a certain velocity. FlexRadio has obviously been an advocate pushing the technology forward for the last 10, 15 years. And it is... the technology is now mainstream. Now that other major radio vendors are deciding that that they need to be getting into this space for building radios using this technology, it's going to greatly accelerate what's happening. I think probably within the next 10 years. There's not going to be a radio made that that is not at least 80% or more a software defined product.
Okay, so 10 years is kind of the safe zone.
Yeah, I think
for
so.
Looking at this stuff.
Yeah. Well, things don't really move real fast in our market.
Yeah. I mean, it's not a hugely profitable market.
Yeah. Gerald's presentation the other day showed a slide. He asked everybody, "Do you know when the super heterodyne?" Receiver came about and
30s sometime, wasn't it?
It was 1918, Armstrong.
It was a Spark Superhead.
Yeah, it was a Spark Superhead. So it's had a pretty good run, almost 100 years, but it's being superseded. It has been superseded, and SDR clearly has a lot of advantages, and I think it's not a surprise that other people are embracing it. It's just Flex saw it early.
Yeah. Don brings up a really good point. I think one of the things that's really helped market acceptance, and this was true when the SDR 1000 came out in 2004, was that we had a little box here that was $1,000 that had receiver performance that exceeded radio, the superhet radios that cost $15,000, and that was really the key market differentiators that people traditionally the more you paid the better receiver you got. Well, we blew that out of the water. You didn't have to pay, you didn't have to mortgage the house and sell the kids to get a top-end type receiver. And so SDRs, I think that was the first big market mover that really got people's attention. And nowadays, if you go out and you look at the independent labs that do receiver testing, Rob Sherwood, if you look at the top of the list, it's SDRs that are on the top of the list there, along with a couple of the superhets from Elecraft that have really optimized that technology, and they also make a great radio.
I got two things I want to go. I got lots of directions I want to go, but two immediately. One is the little dongle SDRs. But first is the testing methods. They had to relearn how to test to be able to figure out what your receivers could do.
Yes, correct.
Have they done that?
To a certain degree, they're evolving their testing methods. There were tests that that made absolutely no sense that when run against an SDR. versus
when those first happened, did you have to go, but hey, wait a minute,
yeah.
or were they just saying, look,
process,
it's a terrible
yeah.
radio, look yeah. at the spec?
Well, there was two sides of that. I mean, you know, there were certain tests that you ran where an SDR looked really, really bad, and then there were certain tests that you ran where an SDR was so much more better than different radios. Blocking dynamic range was one of them.
Was the good one or the bad one?
Well, it was actually one of the good ones, because if you look at the dynamic range, of some of these radios, and you equate that to what the A to D looks like, you know, you're talking about blocking dynamic range that were, 180 and 190 dB, which was just, the number makes no sense. And I think that's the other side of that equation also didn't make any sense, where, you had a radio that you could listen to it, obviously know that it's a great receiver, and you'd look at the number and say, well, based on the number, this thing should be deaf as a post. And so there has been some educational processes. We've worked really closely with the ARRL and Mr. Ellison there, who runs the testing, and some of the other independent labs in the area, and we're getting to the point where the test scenarios are being optimized depending on the technology that you're using. And I think as more and more radios become software defined and have particularly the direct sampling technologies come to the market, you're going to see a fine-tuning of those testing suites to match those products.
Is it actually possible to get really good measurement for what you're doing?
Yes.
Yeah, it is. It is. And in fact, I think it's interesting, Tim, a little QRM there, but Tim mentioned one of the sort of benchmark test labs is Rob Sherwood. NC0B has been testing radios for probably 25 years for various capabilities, various parameters. And he's the golden rule or the quest today is close-based reciprocal mixing numbers, dynamic range. So that's how he has them ordered. He has two tones separated by a small space, which is more sort of real world. When you use your radio, you're contending with signals that are all around you, very strong signals, very weak signals. So the holy grail is what's the highest dynamic range for close space tones. And the Flex Radio 6700 is on top of that pile at 108 dB. Tremendous receiver. Others are quite close to it. But that's sort of a real world, how does this radio work when compared to other people? What are how does it work when you have strong signals right next to a very weak signal you're trying to hear? So that's been sort of the golden rule now. Which one is best?
When you're measuring a test like that, is that more effective when you're talking about a CW contact? Does it really play into having a phone contact where the signals are broader and
Well, as it turns out, with a direct sampled receiver, it doesn't matter how close those two tones are together. If they're 100 cycles apart or they're 2 kilohertz apart, the number's still the same. It's just inherent in the direct sampled receivers. That falls out of the equation. It doesn't matter. You can put the two signals very close together. It doesn't matter. The other aspect, and radios have really improved in this, and I think, again, Flex set the tone. Once the radios get to a certain point, they're so good, the thing that is the limiting factor becomes the phase noise of the radio. Phase noise is just a reality. It happens when you have oscillators running. They always create a little bit of jitter, other than a crystal oscillating at a single frequency is still the best you can get. Most of these radios, or all of these radios, are digitally synthesized. They all have some jitter. They all have some phase noise. But when the dynamic range gets 100 dB or better, the phase noise is really the driving, the biggest remaining bad piece, so you want to minimize that. Flex went to great pains to put a very high-quality DDS, direct digital synthesizer, in there, excuse me, that has very, very low phase noise. And in fact, it rivals some of the best test equipment out there, so it's kind of a challenge to test it to see how good it really is. And
that's
some
where
other
I was
radios,
coming from with these things you can't actually measure. Because
yeah,
you
can actually measure them. It just gets difficult, and you need really good test equipment to measure them.
Yeah. Okay. You had mentioned that you know, suddenly a $1,000 receiver was doing as well as a $100,000 receiver. What about a $10 receiver? you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, sure.
How good are they?
Well, they're very good receivers, obviously. And for people who are, you know, wanting to experiment, get into the SDR arena and whatnot, those are very cost-effective devices to experiment with.
What does a FlexRadio receiver do that, I mean, besides being able to split it out into eight receivers and monitors and all that stuff, because this is just going to be a single receiver, but it's still really wide range. It's mm-hmm. still doing its demodulation in software. It's still any mode you can get the software to do. Where are its compromises? What doesn't it do very well? I guess it probably won't handle those wide signal disparities very well.
They generally, you're talking about the little dongles, the plug-in dongles. Everybody
like
has
RTL
a couple of them.
RTL or something like
that?
Yeah,
sure, everybody. I have one. I use it essentially as an off-the-air monitor. When I'm transmitting, I have one plugged in. I watch my signal real-time. I know what it looks like. But they generally have 8-bit A-to-D converters in there. The dynamic range is in the range of 50 or 60 dB. But it's good enough for a lot of people, and they're really fun to play with.
Yeah.
But they
can get decent selectivity.
Yeah, but they don't have front-end filters, bandpass filters, as the better radios have.
So they can be overloaded by strong fields way out of band.
Yeah, exactly. They have terrible phase noise. But if you just want to use it to listen around the bands, they're really fun.
Okay, so everybody should have a $10 receiver and a reasonably priced FlexRadio series.
Absolutely.
So we said that designing software for software-defined radios is not child's play. It's not first-year engineering. Are we going to start battling? There's always been a battle of the engineers, you know, whether it's no matter how the radio, you know, function, analog radios or whatever. I mean, Collins was in that battle back in the 40s and 50s. How is a ham observing the market and trying to decide what radio to buy, other than just buy a Flex radio? Who's not going to be a software expert? You know, what terms are we going to be throwing at them? What should they be paying attention to?
Right. Well, I think one of the things that it boils down to is that, you know, most hams are pragmatist. You know, they want to get on the air, they want to operate, they want to make contacts, whether it's rag chewing or contesting and things of that nature.
And they'll have a budget, some higher than others.
And they're going to have a budget. And so they're going to basically, you know, make their purchasing decision based on the value of the features that they need for their particular type of operating. And
Would we say that not all radios will have the same features? Because it seems like they kind of could.
Well, I think they're going to have the same core features. I mean, you know, obviously you're going to have, you know, demodulation, modulation, or modes in the radio, whether it's AM, FM, sideband, or whatever. You're going to have filtering. You're going to have noise mitigation, noise reduction, noise blanking, things of that nature. Where it's going to differentiate is how well those features actually work. You know, how sharp are the filters? You know, what is the propagation delay through the filtering? For those kind of things, for noise mitigation, you know, how well does it remove power line noise? How well does it remove rain static and things of that nature? And so there's, you know, those are the kind of things that are going to differentiate. Once you get beyond the core radio features, and these are the things that you would expect in a software-defined radio or a traditional superhet type radio, then you're going to look at the extensibility that Don kind of alluded to. You know, what else can you do with your radio other than, you know, turn it on and tune somebody in? And FlexRadio has taken the direction that we wanted to build an extensible platform. We wanted to build something that that the experimenter could use. And because of that, we have created a smart SDR ecosystem that's open, that has programming APIs. You know, Joe Ham off the street, you know, can write an application that they can load into our radio. You know, if somebody, you know, some bright individual comes up with a brand new digital mode or digital voice mode, and they want to put that on the air, the Flex Smart SDR ecosystem allows them to build what we call a waveform, install it in the radio, and now you have a brand new mode in there. And it's those type of extensible features that are also going to be differentiators. One of the other things it's going to be a big deal in coming years, and it is a big deal now, is remote access. People want to use their radio when they're not in the shack, and they want to use the internet as that connecting medium to allow them to access their radio. And there's been ways of connecting to your radio remotely for years. It's required engineering several pieces of software together and making things work, kind of a patchwork quilt of things with VPNs and voice over IP technology and screen remote screen capture type software. But one of the things that Flex is going to be introducing here in the next couple of months is a seamless way of connecting a smart SDR client or the software that you use to run the radio with a radio somewhere in the internet. We're going to allow you to create a secure session across the internet that allow you to get to your radio and use it anywhere that you have internet connectivity with sufficient bandwidth, and do this seamlessly. It's not going to require a kludge of hardware or modifying firewalls or things that, you know, the average ham just might make their head explode. You know, we want to make it seamlessly, you know, as a point and click kind of scenario. And
your connection would be one data stream that contains control, audio both ways.
Well, from a technology standpoint, we utilize two different types of data streams because the data is unique in itself. Command and control of the radio is done through a TCP connection, which is a reliable, acknowledged connection. Any of the audio, the screen displays, the metering, things like that, we do that through a UDP stream with a VITA 49 protocol.
Okay, so not a single stream, but a two.
No, it's a dual stream.
All right. Those features all sound understandable. Some of them may be a little bit more groundbreaking and take you aback a little bit and say, whoa, radio can do that now? Cool. But is there going to be a manufacturer's war of indecipherable terminology about SDR? Or is it all going to go so deep under the hood that it is all just how you play with the radio? Because there's some hams that even today with the analog radios, they get very deep into the technology that most of us don't understand, but they do. And they're fighting for the last half a dB and arguing about which way is going to be better. Are we going to see a software-defined version of that?
Well, I think you have that right now with traditional radios. You know,
there are
hams that'll argue about, you know, my dynamic range has 1 dB better than your dynamic range and whatnot. And then there's hams that...
But they argue about how, and those are those are arguments that I can't make because I don't have the background.
But I think for a majority of users, are mostly pragmatic. You know, they want a good radio that is reliable, does what they want it to do. When they turn it on, they want to make contacts, they want to have fun. You know, it's a hobby. We want to have fun. And so I think the terminology is going to change, obviously. You know, we're going to be talking about gigaflops and FFT bins and things of that nature rather than, tolerances on resistors. So it's going to evolve. But I think we're always going to have the on one end of the scale, the high-end geeks, and on the other end of the scale, the guy that just wants to turn the radio on and talk to his buddy, you know, in the next day.
Yeah, and the challenge is making those really complex things appear simple. It's always a goal of Flex to make the radio work well and make it fairly easy to use by everybody, yet to have the capability, the extensibility to serve the really high-end demanding user as well. And it's really difficult. You have the average user just says, how good is good enough? That's one of the reasons that Flex has a spectrum of radios available, you know, from all using the same essential platform, but slight differentiation. You know, the entry-level 6000 radio has two receivers, two slices. The middle one has four. The top one has eight, you know, for the super demandy guy. But the challenge is still to make something really complex appear simple. And that's always utmost in the mind of the Flex engineers. And they've done a really good job of it.
That's me as your target audience for that.
Yeah.
So I'm glad you mentioned the broad spectrum of things, because that gives me the entree to mention a booth a couple of aisles over, the DV4 guys coming out with a radio, their DV4 mobile. We're changing the definition of multi-mode. Multi-mode used to be AM, sideband, CW, maybe RIDI or the easy capability of some data modes. Multi-mode today, to some of us, is FM, D-Star, DMR, System Fusion, Codec 2, P25. That becomes a multi-mode radio to some people, and they're building a radio like that. They've got prototype on display over there. Are you seeding that market to them?
No, actually, I believe that that we broke ground in that market. We were the innovator there by we were the first radio that allowed extensible waveforms to be added into the radio. We added the free DV codec. We've added D-Star into our radios, which are add-in modes. Those are software-defined modes that that you can put into the radio. And everything you just mentioned, we can put that in too. It's just it's in the software business. We call it just a simple matter of programming, which is, you know,
which makes your software engineer go,
yes.
They hate it when you say that.
Yes, a little facepalm. So we're not succeeding to that, but there is a market for these kind of digital voice type modes, and so we're seeing mode evolution in our hobby, yeah. And Flex Radio is well situated to handle that.
Their form factor is a little mobile VHF, UHF radio, although
right.
In the interview I did with Uli, they're planning a module to add on that will take it down to HF.
Right.
And it is perhaps the first serious full software-defined radio for VHF, UHF digital modes. So that would be a new form factor for Flex,
yeah.
Mobile radio on VHF, UHF. I guess that may be the market I'm asking for.
Right. So as far as markets are concerned, we're always analyzing what the market is doing. We're always analyzing the capability or the potential of what's happening there. You know, obviously it takes a lot of resource to go design and build a radio. It's not something that's simple, and it takes even more resource to bring one to market and to sell it. And so so we're always looking at that. Will the mobile VHF market be broad enough that that Flex Radio can be the number one player or a number one player in that market? We'll just have to see.
One of the things, if I could include, I wouldn't call it a mode, but one of the really powerful and compelling features of SDR radios is the visual mode. Radio has become, with the introduction of software-defined radios, not just something you put headphones on your head or you listen to a speaker. It becomes a visual interaction with the radio, really optimized by Flex Radio and now embraced by others.
You're talking about the spectrum scopes.
I'm talking about the spectrum
scope,
the
waterfalls.
Yeah. It is an incredibly valuable and powerful tool to operating a radio today. It was honestly the thing that captured me in the early days of the power of being able to see and to visualize what's going on the band. I tend to chase DX, and everybody's looking for a competitive advantage in chasing DX. And the ability to see what's going on and to listen and visually spot where he's listening, or to see the trends. Most DX stations, the expeditions operate split. They're transmitting on one frequency. Everybody in the world's calling them 5 or 10 or 30 or 50 kilohertz up the band. And before SDR, you simply parked on a frequency and you called your brains out and hoped they heard you. That's changed with the visual capabilities of these radios. Now you can see where the pileup is. You can see open spots, and it works. It absolutely works. So that, I won't call it a mode, but we were talking about modes. Radios have become visual. There's another dimension to radio now that wasn't there before SDR. Yeah.
I was talking to some DXers, contesters at the end of the Hamfest yesterday, some old line guys, and I don't know exactly where how the contest wound or the conversation wound around to it, but new stuff versus old stuff, new ways of doing things versus old, and you know they were tending to liking the old ways of doing things. And I said, so do you use spotting? Oh, yeah. I mean, the really old school is you found your DX by turning the dial.
Correct.
You know, you didn't know where he was going to be. No one was telling you. You stumbled across him, and you just hunted a lot. So they nodded and said, okay, yeah, you got your point. That was the hard way, and in some ways that was the fun way. And today, if you don't use the networks, well, you're not going to be competitive. You can still have fun, but you're not going to be competitive. All right, I think I got what I was looking for here.
Excellent, good.
Is there anything that has been churning in your brain since I wish you'd ask me or I get a chance to say?
No, it's been fun.
It has been. Thank you, Gary. We appreciate the opportunity to come talk with you.
Yeah, and this is actually more fun than you think, right?
So, yes.
Not so bad. All right, thank you, guys. Let me do my fundraising here. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. Stop by hamradionow.tv, see Arvin at the bottom of the page. Patreon, credit card, PayPal, individual contributions, subscription, whatever it takes. So this is a lot of equipment here. It's expensive to do. These guys are demanding SAG rates for appearing on the program. And they're not going to get them. I asked to see their union cards, and they didn't produce them yet. So I left them at home. Yeah. Send me a bill.
Okay.
All right. See you guys. Over and out.
Bye. Thank you, Gary.
Bye.